Odumegwu Ojukwu, head of an independent state, not the young Emeka whom I had known in Yaba, Lagos in the early 50s. I outlined my mission. I was there to persuade him to call a halt to the firing from his side while one more effort was made to resolve the conflict between the federal government and its now seceded state. The sticky point, however, was that this would require placing a hold on the secession. That's Soyinka there. He has told us his mission to Biafra. Was that not a good mission?
Thank you. Till tomorrow, it remains not only a good mission, but a patriot's move to save unnecessary wastages of lives and property in their millions. So may the souls of all those who died in the Nigeria Civil War continue to rest in peace. Now, before declaring Eastern Region of Nigeria the Republic of Biafra, Lieutenant Colonel Chukwumeka Odumegwu Ojukwu had stood on the outcome of the Aburi meeting between him and the then military head of state of Nigeria, then Lieutenant Colonel Yakubu Gawan, that the regions will get more autonomy, Nigeria will be run on a federal system. On getting back to Nigeria, some federalists, particularly civil servants, permanent secretary at the federal level, studied the papers and told Yakubu Gawan to his face that you have come with a paper that has dissolved the Federal Republic of Nigeria because it allowed for autonomy for the regions.
Is that not true?
Everything about Nigeria in the past, very true and relevant as we speak today, Saturday, 1st of May, 2021. The Federalists were led by the immediate past Oba of Benin.
Oba Iredia.
Ukwa Polopolo. He was then a federal permanent secretary. So he was among the team that studied the paper brought from Aburi, Ghana. And they told Gawan, sir, you've sold out Nigeria. It's just a moment of a strike of the pen. Bye-bye, Nigeria. So he asked, what should we do? They said, don't abide by this agreement. And that was the main cause of the war.
Ojukwu said on Aburi we stand.
That is it. Aburi is available now on the streets, social media, for those who are not born in 1966-67 to study. Because the agreement was, let us go back to the founding fathers' agreement that the regions will control certain aspects of their resources, talent, and vision. So we come to the federal level on basis of equality, which had been overturned by the May 21 decree of 1966 of Major General JTU Agui Iransi. Agui Iransi turned Nigeria from federation to group of provinces, whereby civil servants can be taken from Okigwe to Ikire or to Kaura Namuria on transfer. So the Hausas, the Northerners, look at themselves and said, what is our percentage at the federal level? What is the level of our education to compare to the South? And they said, this is bringing to light the forecast of Dr. Nnamdi Azikiwe. I quote Azikiwe now. It's only a matter of moment that Nigeria will be controlled by the Igbos.
Now, the Aburi confusion led us to war.
Did you say confusion?
Yes.
Okay.
I said confusion.
Yes, you have it right.
Because if you ask some federalists, they will tell you that they did not back out of the agreement. So that Ojukwu misinterpreted the agreement.
No.
Ojukwu was prepared for Aburi. Do you wonder why Gowon and others were not as prepared as Ojukwu for that meeting?
Excuse me, please. With due respect to the passing of General Yakubu Gowon, today is a PhD holder in political science, obtained from Warwick University, United Kingdom. With all due respect to him, as at the time of the crisis, 1966, 67, 68, 69, until it was toppled, Yakubu Gowon was, far below the academic level of Lieutenant Colonel Odumeke Ojukwu.
Ojukwu was an Oxford graduate.
Man, King's College, Lagos. Oxford University, MA.
He also went to Epsom College in London.
Oh, God. And he was a rugby player for his school, UK. So, Ojukwu did not see Gowon as his mate.
They said he took all of them to the cleaners. They were just listening to him at the discussion in Aburi.
Ojukwu was prepared. Ojukwu had set up a cabinet and they had developed papers for presentation at Aburi. I'm sorry to say this. 80% of those who went to Aburi went on a jamboree. They thought it was that easy. Ojukwu, welcome. We are brothers. Let us forget our differences. No. He said, no, please. This is a serious matter. He was just opening his briefcase. Paper one, paper two, paper three. And they were just looking at him.
So the unprepared Gowon could govern Nigeria for 9 years. An unprepared leader.
Excuse me. Okay. For the sake of history and the academia and grassroots people, my people, grassroots, listening to us, I will have to be empirical, as always. I will mention names, dates, and places because not many people were born 1966, 1967. Yakubu Gowon was an incidental head of state.
Why was he not Murtala Muhammad? He led the coup.
The Murtala Muhammad, again, with due respect to all these people I'm mentioning, that is why those of us who are living must be careful about history, posterity, because history does not spare anybody. Murtala Muhammad was a hothead. Hothead. With temper. So, the northern people met after the January 15, 1966 coup, which, if we analyze it today, was one-sided. The losses were many in northern Nigeria, western Nigeria, zero level, eastern region.
Does that make it an Igbo coup?
No! The man who came out as the leader of the coup, Major Chukwuma Kaduna Nzego, was not Igbo.
He's from Okpanam. Okpanam is Igbo. Those that on the other side of the Niger.
Thank you. But today, everybody's claiming autonomy. I sent you about 2 weeks ago my tribute to Eddie Okonta.
Yes.
When Eddie Okonta was alive, the king Obi of trumpet, many people thought, Obi Okonta, Eddie Okonta, Igbo now. No, Onisha Ugbo, the area you are referring to. Good. So, Nze Ugu himself was not the architect of the coup. The architect of the coup was that Nigerian who first won a medal.
Ifeajuna.
Thank you. Of the former University College Ibadan.
Yeah.
Thank you. I pray he's still alive. I interviewed the surviving major of the 5 majors who carried out the January 15, 1966 coup, Major Ade Moyega, for my program, Speak Out, on NTA Ibadan. Then it was NTV, sometime in 1981. And he wrote a book.
Why We Strong.
Thank you. So the facts are there. He is not an Igbo coup. But in the execution, officers who are allotted to carry out operations in the eastern region of Nigeria develop conflict. So the premier of northern, the premier of eastern region, Dr. Michael Ianotu Opara, escaped because he was hosting Archbishop Makarios of Greece, who was in Nigeria for the Commonwealth Conference. One of the reasons that led to the assassination of Abubakar Tafawa Balewa. They said, Nigeria was burning, and you are calling a conference to resolve the issues in the former, what do they call it then? South Africa today, Rhodesia.
Zimbabwe.
South Africa, the original one where Ian Smith was their prime minister.
Yes, that is Zimbabwe. Good. Today's Zimbabwe.
Thank you. So, they carried out the coup, January 15, 1966. And when the final result came out, Prime Minister Nodana assassinated, Finance Minister Kotiebo, Midwest or Bende region, assassinated, Premier Ladoke Akintola, Yoruba, assassinated, Premier Madubelo, Northern Region, assassinated, Kone Maimalamari, assassinated, Brigadier Ademulegun, assassinated, Kone Ko, assassinated, Northern and Western Region.
Mm.
Let's be fair. But it was not the intention of Nzogu to be passed here.
The men that were kept in Lagos to take out Agui Iranzi developed cold feet.
Agui Iranzi was saved by the fact that he went to a party and he returned home late at night. They were there in his barracks.
So they wanted to get him too?
Oh, he was. The head of the military, otherwise, they wouldn't take control of the army.
Okay, let's assume Igbo officers, majorly Igbo officers, executed the coup.
Yes.
He took another Igbo officer in Kanu, Odumegwu Ojukwu, to stop the coup.
Thank you. Ojukwu had always been ambitious. Ojukwu, when he returned from the university, told his father that he wanted to join the army. And the father said, on his deathbed, you will go to the army. I want you to go to the civil service. With this master's degree, you will rise to the top. Ojukwu refused. But just to listen to his father, he took the civil service form and they posted him to Enugu. That was where he first met Lieutenant Colonel Adekunle Fajuyi, because he wanted to romanticize with the army, his ambition, his love. Eventually, Ojukwu had to go to the north to be recruited as a sergeant. He didn't present his certificate because he knew his inner intention would be to get to the army and take power one day.
He has always loved power.
Oh, he loved it.
He stopped in Nzogu school in the north.
Yes, he did.
Agui Iranzi stopped the coup in Lagos.
Yes.
Both Igbo men.
Yeah. And they got Nzogu to come. Nzogu wanted to fly to Lagos and finish the job.
Yes.
Because he held a press conference January 16, 1966, with Hassan Kassina holding the microphone on his behalf.
A northern officer.
Northern officer is junior. And because he had broken his arm when he jumped down from the residence of Sir Ahmadu Bello. And his intention was to come to Lagos, finish the assignment that some people ran away from, and take power. And as he said, they wanted to rule for just 6 months and bring Awolowo out of prison in Calabar. Install him as the prime minister, and the army will give him back in with muscle. That what you have turned Western Region to, now turn Nigeria to. And immediately Awolowo stabilizes, Nzogu wrote this down. He will now resign his commission in the Nigerian army and go to South Africa to go and fight apartheid. To show you that Nzogu was really...
He was a revolutionary.
He was. Really, he didn't want the airship of the military government that to come up, no.
Let's look at how Soyinka comes into the story. Why all this happened? He was building his literary skills.
Oh, yes.
It was already known.
Yes.
He wanted to intervene intellectually.
Yes.
They thought of a third force,
yes,
to make the difference.
Yes.
Therefore, he traveled to the east to see Ojukwu.
At the risk of his life. At the risk of his personal life. Why? Before declaring Eastern Region the Republic of Biafra, Ojukwu and his cabinet had thought deep that they must extract all non-Easterners out of the region. So Ojukwu made a broadcast, more or less a decree, that non-Easterners get out of this region within so-so date. Whether you are working with Nigerian Railways, Post Office, or you are a suya, seller, buyer, private individual, out. Bankers, whatever national you say you are working in this region. So he pushed everybody out. By the time he finished that, Eastern region could relatively be said to be free of non-Easterners.
And this was when Soyinka wanted to plunge in.
And that is when he went, alone. He left his school of drama, now called the Department of Theatre House, University of Ibadan, where he was the head. Drove to Lagos, spent a night, went to Benin, spent a night, and went to Enugu, all alone. Lonely road, which you could say was studded with dynamite.
If you want to read Soyinka's story, get his book, You Must Set Forth at Dawn. He explained his action here.
Thank you. So, getting to Enugu, you've read the part now, the portion where he met with Ojukwu and they had the discussion.
He also met with Victor Banjo.
Oh, because Victor Banjo was an, if with all respect, equal of Professor Wole Soyinka in academics. And Banjo was also a nationalist. Otherwise, he had every chance to escape from the claws Ojukwu had put him in.
But again, he also placed himself in certain confusion. What was his agenda? His agenda was different from Ojukwu's agenda.
Ojukwu, note, had always been ambitious, one. Two, Ojukwu did not regard Yakubu Gowon as his mate. Three, Ojukwu wanted Gowon or the federal military government to tell us exactly what happened in Ibadan on the night of dawn of January 15, 1966. The same government house at Agodi. Incidentally, I was there last night.
But Gowon did tell him at a Buri conference. Gowon, they even said, okay, we'll show you where they were buried.
What led to that? Treachery. Deceit. Because however modern intelligence grew today, it started from somewhere. General Ironsi had notice of an impending counter coup.
Mm-hmm.
Part of his agenda of meeting the traditional rulers in the north, east, midwest, then finally western region, where the helicopter would pick him up in the morning of January 15, 1966, was the dinner the previous night on the Western House lawns. And repeatedly he was asking the meeting governor of Western Region,
Fajuyi,
Francis, are you sure I'm safe? Because he wanted to leave that night. He had got information, intelligence report. And Fajuyi, in all innocence, said, sir, you are more than safe.
But should he be asking Fajuyi that question? He was the commander-in-chief.
Supreme commander.
So?
At this time, they were using supreme commander. He was supreme commander. But they were friends, even though he's senior. Ironsi was Fajuyi's senior. But they had that camaraderie when they were in Congo. Ironsi was commanding the Nigerian United Nations contingent. And Fajuyi was part of Nigerian and United Nations contingent. And they fell together. They were friends, even though there was the disparity of senior junior. So Fajuyi, naturally as a Yoruba man, will consider it an abomination. You went to the north, nothing happened to you. You went to east, nothing. You came here from the Midwest. Sir, you are safe.
But he wasn't safe.
He didn't know.
His ADC was part of the plot.
Oh, God. What they did was just to supplant the ADC,
I'm talking about Theophilus Danjuma.
Thank you. And some officers, because Danjuma worked himself into the convoy of Ironsi that visited the north, east, midwest, and they had their plan to carry out in Ibadan. So Danjuma went to sleep at Letmore Barracks and not the government house or the guest house that was allocated to him. And so as not to let the cat out of the bag, he borrowed the uniform, which he wore at around 2 a.m. to lead that contingent to government house, Agodi. So everything appeared perfect, but by midnight, they had swapped the guards that Ironsi and Fajuyi knew were there on the first day, second day. So they had swapped them, making it very easy for them to penetrate the gatehouse, government house, Agodi Ibadan. The gate was already open because it was timed. And when they entered, in the commotion, Ironsi was dressing up upstairs with all due modesty. With all due modesty, I cannot claim to know the geography of Gombe House if I don't anymore, because I left that place 32 years ago. But I knew the bedroom of the governors, because I served four of them. Chibolege, retired Major General Olada Kukwala, Brigadier General Adetunji Oluni, and the late Brigadier General Shasha Eniyan Oresanya. So, Ironsi was dressing up in one of the upper rooms, waiting to take his breakfast. The helicopter will arrive and carry him to Lagos. Faji was already there in the sitting room, waiting for his master, his supreme commander, to come down the stairs. When these soldiers just rushed in, he was baffled. And he saw Danjuma, what's his name? Garba, Joe Garba, and Husseini. And they saluted him. And he was shocked. And he said, what's happening? And they said, sir, we have not come for you. Is that man? Where is he? And they were calling Ironsi by name. Huh? Abomination. British trained officers. He said, what? Ironsi was hearing the commotion upstairs. So he died Lagos. And who was to take it in Lagos? The chief of army staff, Lieutenant Colonel Yakubu Gawan. That's why Mrs. Ironsi will tell you that she was hearing the conversation between Gawan and Ironsi. And Gawan, only God knows, still claiming his innocence till tomorrow, he said he was not sure there would be any harm done to him and his host. But by then, they were losing temper. Remember, coup, military coup. If you are caught, you are gone. Time's ticking away. And they were in a rush. So they just carried him, removed the epaulets, removed his uniform, and pushed him down. And they told Faji, we've told you we are not here for you. This is the man we are after. And thrice they dissuaded Faji from joining them, from following Ironsi. And he was telling them, you did not take him in the north, you didn't take him in the east, in the Midwest. Why do you want to take him from my own base? Where do you want me to put my face? Where do you want the Yoruba people to put their faces? So when they saw that he was not going to budge, they pushed him to the Land Rover and drove all the way from Iwo Road into the bush where the epitaph lays today. I am the founding honorary secretary at the Adekunle Faji Foundation. And we pursued it to the logical end. May God bless the soul of the immediate past governor of Oyo State, because he bought our idea, erected the cenotaph at the spot where Faji and Ironsi were undressed, whipped, and made to dig their shallow graves.
Oh, that's the story of Nigeria.
Yes.
Soyinka went to Ojukwu, and Gowon did not take that lightly. He was arrested for going to Biafra.
Yes.
He spent 2 years in prison, 1967 to 1969.
He will tell you he didn't go to prison. He will tell you he was in detention without end, indefinite detention in Kaduna prison. Because there was no trial that found him guilty. He was clamped in detention, and that's what brought the first instance of me, Ombu Sef, and Professor Wole Soyinka, then Mr. Soyinka, as at that time, into contact. My father bought me a transistor radio set in 1963 when I was in primary six as a present for my leadership, thank God. I entered secondary school 1964 from one African Church Grammar School, Apata Ganga, Ibadan. I had a classmate and friend. We bought a copy of Daily Times every day from our pocket money, and I had my transistor radio set. So you must come to me and Alan for the latest date and update in world affairs. Lo and behold, Daily Times that morning, we bought it. Blazing headline: Wole Soyinka will remain in prison as long as the war lasts. Gawan, our hero, because Soyinka has been my hero from 1960. So what's his offense? I read the full story. They didn't say any offense. What is the indefinite detention case?
He went to Biafra. Yeah. That's an offense.
Ah, to me, till now, I don't see it as an offense.
He went to discuss with the enemy.
No. Why are we saying Nigeria is one?
He went to plot a third force.
Which force? Didn't Ojukwu contest as senator for in Nigeria? Nigeria is a big lie.
A big lie?
Yes. Ojukwu came back and National Party of Nigeria wanted to score a cheap point, granted him asylum. If you saw the crowd that welcomed Ojukwu at Ikeja Airport, put that one aside. Ojukwu was persuaded to come and contest for senatorial seat under the platform of MPN.
It was part of the deal he signed before he was allowed back into the country.
That's part of the
lie. He went on exile to Cote d'Ivoire.
Nigeria is a big lie. Lie, L-I-E.
Oloyelekan Alabi's on state affairs. We'll be back after this break. Don't go away.
State Affairs with Edmond Obilo is live.
Splash FM 105.5.
At Splash FM, we believe that the business of broadcasting in today's society should not only be about information dissemination, but ultimately about the quality of those who do the job. Our next agenda is to restore and consolidate the integrity of broadcasting, to train, to equip, and to mentor the next generation in the art and science of broadcasting, leveraging over a decade of excellence in the industry. Anticipate.
Do you know that you have the right to quality broadcasting? The National Broadcasting Commission says any person, group of persons, or organization aggrieved by the content of a broadcast or the conduct of a broadcast station may lodge a complaint to the station and or write to the Director General, National Broadcasting Commission, number 20, Ibrahim Taiwo Street, Asokoro, Abuja. Or send a mail via info@nbc.gov.ng. Please ensure that your complaint includes name of the broadcast station, title of the program, date and time of broadcast, and essence of the complaint. Also, remember to include your name, address, telephone number, email, and append your signature. Note that your complaint must reach the NBC within 14 days of the queried broadcast. NBC, your right to quality broadcasting.
Thank you.
With almost 100,000 Instagram followers and over 100,000 followers on Twitter.
Wow.
And more than a quarter of a million followers on Facebook. Our followers are our greatest assets. Join our social media family for breaking news, daily information, and giveaways. Instagram and Twitter at Splash FM 1055. On Facebook at www.facebook.com/SplashFM105.5.
Splash FM 105.5.
State Affairs with Edmond Obilo is live.
So when you saw the headline on the front page of the Daily Times,
yes,
you wrote a letter to go on.
And the second day.
So tell me about the letter.
Thank you. You know, I was born Friday, October 27, 1950. And that's how I became 70 last year, October. Thank God. So 1967, I was just 17 years old. And they formed three students of African Church Grammar School, Apata Ganga Ibadan. So the second day, I went back to the paper, newspaper, Daily Times. Thinking to myself, Wole Soyinka will stay in prison as long as the war lasts. Do you know when the war will last? That's my first question to myself and to General Gawan. Second one, what was his offense? He now said he went to meet with Ojukwu at the risk of his life. Instead of you to follow advanced countries of the world, they will be worshipping the types of Soyinka to deduce information, the secrets. What did he tell you? What did he notice? Now you just grab the man, drove him to Panti, and you are questioning him.
And Soyinka accused Obasanjo of that plot.
Now they are friends now. They have been friends since Obasanjo was the commander of Ibadan Garrison organization.
Because so, Soyinka, when he came back from that trip, went to see Obasanjo.
That's another story. So I took Kinonkwe, Ajako, because we were on break.
Mm-hmm.
School. Our school was on break. So I was home. And where I was home and still home, Ile Kenya Jengbe, SW1/131. We are the owners of Ipondiku Masquerade, one of the five leading masquerades in this town. Ibadan, Kabi Salailua, Oba Olubadan, Adetuji, Ajegunso, Manimong Python. So I bought what they call Ajako writing sheets. Three. One, first letter was to General Gawan, General Yakub Gawan, head of state, Dodan Barracks, Lagos. I introduced myself. I am so, from three student African Church Grammar School, Apata Ganga Ibadan. Paragraph two, sir, I read the headline story yesterday in the Daily Times where you are quoted as saying that Wole Soyinka will remain in prison as long as war lasts. Sir, I don't think this is fair. Third paragraph, I want to beg you of two favors. Please release Mr. Soyinka or take him to a court of law. Thank you. Signed. Posted. At the same Ojaba post office. Posted. Soyinka, same paragraph. But this time, Mr. Wole Soyinka, care, chief warder, Kaduna Prison, Kaduna. Same intro. Second paragraph. Sir, I've read yesterday's Daily Times headline front page where the head of state said you will remain in prison as long as the war lasts. I've interfered on your behalf to the head of state that I don't consider this action as being fair.
Where did you get that got from as a secondary school student?
Where did I get the got from? I've always been asked that question since it became known that I wrote Soyinka. And I always say it's due to my progeny and my destiny. And by progeny, I mean my ancestry. I am the fourth traditional chief in my family. Our progenitor, Omolaja Ekene Ajengbe, was Ekene Balogun of this town. His son, Suberu Ajengbe, was Ekene Balogun of this town. Their son, Asani Oyinlola, was Agbaakin Balogun, and they fought in all Ibadan wars. Suberu Ajengbe fought in the 1840 Osogbo War, where they drove these Fulani jihadists far back to Ofa. Then my paternal grandmother was the woman leader of NCNC in this town under Adogoke Adelabu. Adelabu would come to our house. Little as I was taken to Adelabu. So my grandmother, who will be 55 years, tomorrow will be the 55th year of her passage, was always asking me, sit down. She will brief me about my ancestry, their exploits, and what she stood for. Those were real politicians. They were not taking money for any party leader then. So I would say my consciousness rose from that time until 1964, when we got to African Church Grammar School, Form 1. And it was dinner all night was Eko and Efo, Eko and Efo. And I was enjoying it as an Ibadan boy, Eko and Efo, until some Ijebus, Igbos, Lagosians in the boarding house said, no, enough of Eko and Efo, because we were next to government college. And there were brothers and friends in government college when they interacted. And we were hearing what government college boys were taking for dinner. Chicken, rice. So there was a protest led by Senior Ogume Khan, which we joined. And we were singing, Ah, wow, Je, Eko, until the school changed our menu. So everybody must fight for justice. Right, freedom.
That was what you did on behalf of Soyinka.
Then it was in one's blood.
In the name of justice.
Oh, that's it.
Then Soyinka came out of prison.
2 years later.
He acknowledged your letter.
He wrote me formally. Soyinka wrote me a letter from UI, formally collected by the school clerk at the Dugbe Post Office, African Church Grammar School, P.O. Box 729, Dugbe, Ibadan.
He asked you to also visit him.
First paragraph. I thank you for your letter, which was delivered to me, among others, on my release from detention. Paragraph 2. Thank you for your solidarity. Feel free to see me at the School of Drama, University of Ibadan. Yes, he invited me.
So when you got there?
He was out of town, according to the secretary. And the Abeokuta that I went to reconnect with him on Thursday, last Thursday, I begged one top official of University of Ibadan. I don't want to mention his name. He has been begging me not to please mention his name. I gave him the assignment 3 months ago. Can you please help me find out if the secretary of Wole Soyinka in 1967 is still alive?
So?
He didn't work on it. If he had done so, I wanted to take him along to Abeokuta. I will ask him to stay outside. Then when we get to the point of the question you ask me now, that I came, but you are set to be out. Your secretary, I just tell him, secretary, come in. But who came in? Do you know what? Julie Coker, the famous Julie Coker, the second face, female face in Africa to appear on television. Mama Anika Waji Williams was the first. Julie Coker came all the way from Wari to give me solidarity on that visit. So, Soyinka.
And that's what you called a 52-year-old appointment kept in 2021.
Yeah, 1969 to 2021, 52 years.
So you finally met Soyinka. Oh, you gave him your autobiography.
I did.
But I wonder why, after he came out from prison, you met him at other occasions.
Thank you.
You refused to tell him you were the young boy that wrote the letter.
No, I was telling him on Thursday. He was just looking at me, amazed. And I believe he was seeing himself in me. His characteristics, I would never beg anybody for favors in my life. I served 4 governors. People were amazed that I was still going to work in Odua. They thought one would have stolen, embezzled. No. I don't beg for favors. I don't. None of the 4 governors did I beg for any favor. The only one that did me a great favor is late. That was Brigadier General Chacha Eniyan Oresanya. My last day in office, March 30, 1989, I went to his office to bid him bye-bye. And at a point, he now said, Alagwa. That's how he called people. Make any wish. Any wish, Alabi. Make any wish and I will grant it on this spot. And I never had that before in my life. Oh. I thought myself. Then I stood up. Your Excellency, thank you, sir. Sir, please, can you sponsor me to Hajj? He was just looking at me. Is that your wish? I said, but if I can make another one. I said, no, just one. I said, now you're asking me if that's my wish. So it was General Resoya from his pocket because I had left his service that I went on pilgrimage in 1989. History repeats itself. I have that published in newspapers and it's in my book. History repeats itself.
You know, I loved your ability to keep records.
Thank you.
It shows the super journalist in you.
Thank you. You too. I was going to commend you because yesterday was Federation of Independent Freelance and Independent Broadcasters of Association of Nigeria National Day yesterday. I was the chair at Yinka Ayifele Music House. And when they asked me to make my remark, I told them, please don't enter the studio without a script. Independence, freelance, independence, broadcaster. You enter the studio. Is then you are going to hear, Ele, Mode, music, again. Music. He's composing the topic, or she's composing in her head. Not, no research. By the time he now says, yeah, Loni, Gwanko Gioro, Agbo, Egbo, Egbo, Tokotia, Obaji, Talo Yako, Kimalaro, Packeti, music. I will tune off because you are unprepared. But look at yourself. I hope people are seeing us on. Do you have a live streaming?
Yeah.
Look at you. It's your character. That's how you are popular with your program and your station. And by extension, our dear chairman, Senior Chibayo Akonde, my uncle and senior on the Olubadan rank, and his wife, Mama Nike Akonde. This is an organized company, broadcast house. You must come to the studio with a script prepared. So, thank you for commending my record keeping ability. I met it at Omni.
Thank you. Now, the battles you saw in the name of justice, we still talk about the same issues
It
in
was
2021.
Not, it was not Soyinka alone, no. It's in the special publication that I used on Thursday and I gave him a copy and the media. I fought for Muhammad Ali, the greatest boxer in the world. 1970, there is a Ring magazine. I don't know whether they still produce it. And they put a page there. They said we should put our name, country, all the details. Why do you think Muhammad Ali's license and crown should be returned to him?
Ali didn't want to go to the Vietnam War. He didn't want to go and fight for America.
Which I supported and still support. He said, I am a Muslim. My religion forbids me to fight a war So the people now saying they are doing jihad, they are not genuine Muslims. He said, my religion does not teach me to fight a war. You must leave everything to God. But he said it was a draft dodger.
Mm.
So we sent in that form to World Boxing Council. And it was overwhelming. So Muhammad Ali went and took a lawyer and they went to court. Supreme Court of US now said World Boxing Council return Muhammad Ali's license and crown. Ditto for June 12th, even though MKO was my mentor and friend, as he would say, you know, Remy, and Askila, Igimujino, sorry, you mean, sorry, you, and many others. People should fight for freedom for others.
And you will not give up fighting.
By the grace of God, I have a destiny which must be fulfilled by the grace of God Almighty. Because it's not my self-interest. So these instances you are quoting, meeting Soyinka, and the first, after the 1969 episode, was when he was going to do audition for his film, Kongi Service, at a Kongi Club. I went, and we were lined up. And I passed the first screening, but the second one, they didn't pick me for the film. When I eventually got back to school, and people had, they said, woman, you should have walked to him now, instead of queuing for audition, that you had me, I never beg for favors.
We just have to go.
Oh, God. Let's go. But before I go, I want to substantiate my claim of saying Nigeria is a big lie. Please, listen to Taffa Balewa, Nigeria's first prime minister, in 1948. I quote him, since 1914, the British government has been trying to make Nigeria into one country. But the Nigerian people themselves are historically different in their backgrounds, religious beliefs and customs, and do not show themselves any signs or willingness to unite. Nigerian unity is only a British invention. Taffa Balewa, 1948.
Yeah.
Okay. Now listen to Nnamdi Azikiwe, 1964. It is better for us and many admirers abroad that we should disintegrate in peace and not in pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Should the politicians fail to heed this warning, then I will venture the prediction that the experience of the Democratic Republic of Congo will be a child's play if ever it comes to our turn to play such a tragic role. Nnamdi Azikiwe, 1964. Obafemi Awolowo. Nigeria is not a nation. It is a mere geographical expression. There are no Nigerians in the same context as there are English, Scots, and Welsh.
Okay.
1947.
Oloye Lokan Alabi.
Yes.
Thank you for featuring on State Affairs.
Thank you for inviting me.
Oloye Lokan Alabi is a Kefa Olubadan of Ibadanland and the first cultural ambassador of the National Museum and Monument, Ile-Ife. I am Edmund Obilo. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Yaganan kilo kilo pejening kom lo moham. Di peja maso sanalom. Uwasa benge kaputo.
State Affairs.
State Affairs with Edmund Obilo.
Don't dare touch that dial. It's Splash 105.5 FM, your integrity station.